Everyone, welcome to my linguistic description of English video series. My name is Daddy. In this video series, I'm going to talk about various topics on linguistics. And in this video today, I'm going to talk about constituency and phrase structure rules in syntax section. Okay, in this presentation today, I'm going to talk about the concept of constituency and phrase structure rules as pertaining to syntax. Previously, we have discussed about parts of speech or the so-called syntactic categories. And we know that in order to be able to generate sentences, native speakers of English have a certain knowledge and intuition about how words are categorized. And then in this study today, I'm going to talk about the sentence structure, as syntax is about the study of sentence structure. Now, some questions arrive, which is what is structure? And then how are words combined into sentences? That is, how are these words structured? And when we are talking about this, we are going to rules. And every language has its own way in combining words into larger units, and these larger units will be also developed into even larger and larger and larger units. And when we are talking about this, we are talking about the concept called constituency. So the lesson objective of today's lesson is first to comprehend the definition, concept, and principle of constituency, particularly in English. And then the second, to conduct basic tests of constituency. We are going to talk about how we determine a certain kind of constituent structure. And then the third, you are going to be able to comprehend the basic concept of phrase structure rules in English. And in the end, we will implement the PSR, phrase structure rules, to analyze English phrases. So in this lesson, we are going to cover several topics. The first one is constituency, and the second one is phrase structure rules. And the third, we are going to learn a little bit about how to create a tree diagrams based on the phrase structure rules. Now, the question is, how is sentence structured? I'm going to do a demonstration here. The first premise that we are going to test today is a sentence is simply a linear string of words. What do I mean by that? For example, we have a sentence, the student loved his syntax assignment, right? If we believe that a sentence is a simply linear string of words, then we know that the student's love his syntax assignment constitute the plus student plus love plus his plus syntax plus assignment. In other words, if we try to analyze this mathematically, we will create an equation A plus B plus D plus E plus F, right? And then there is a characteristic of equation in English, in mathematics, is that when we say A plus B plus C, meaning it is equal to B plus A plus C and C plus B plus A. Right, but we notice that the construction such as love the student syntax is assignment is in ungrammatical, even though it consists of the same components of words. And in the same way, the construction like syntax assignment is love student the his is also considered to be ungrammatical by native speakers of English, even though these two construction similar constituents have similar components that construct the construction. But we know that this is not true. So what is because we argue that construction and 4 and 5 are ill-formed or ungrammatical, so we know that sentence is not linear. It is not simple string of words. So native speakers of English have intuition that sentences are not only created by combining words, whatever they want, right? But there should be something, there should be rules that underlie the principles of how they construct the sentences. And then the second premise that we are going to test today is sentence is sequential, meaning that it consists of sequences of words. Now, let's try to demonstrate this concept by discussing questions. For example, we have a sentence, Chomsky, an extraordinary scientist. Then if we construct a question from this, we will come up with, is Chomsky an extraordinary scientist? Okay, if we think that sentence is really sequential, our intuition will say that, oh, maybe the second component of the sentence, Chomsky is an extraordinary scientist, is moved into the beginning of the construction to create a question. But how about this one? The man is an extraordinary scientist. Okay? If we believe that if in order to create question, we only need to move the second part of the sentence, and then we move man into the beginning, we will come up with construction, man the is an extraordinary scientist, which is ungrammatical. So there is something wrong with this. Sentence is not only moving one part into another part linearly or sequentially. Now let's come up with an even complex, more complex sentence. The man who is standing there can sing beautifully. Okay, if we still believe that we need to move one element, now we may think that the element that we should move is the auxiliary is, right? But if we do that, we derive with this word, is the man who is standing there can sing beautifully, which is ungrammatical. So it is not is, which is move to the beginning, to the front, in order to create question. There must be something else. And this something else is the word can, which is very far away. It's almost at the end of the sentence. But we have to move this, meaning that we have to move a certain component of the sentence, not only any sequence or any number of words or any particular type of word. Instead, we have to move something. So we believe that it means that sentence is not sequential. The words are grouped into larger and larger unit hierarchically, and it is called constituents. And sentences are combination of several constituents. And the operation that take place in the sentence structure are based on this unit of constituents. So this is what we are going to discuss in this lesson. So what is constituency? The demonstration before show us that native speakers of English, for example, have the intuition about their own language in that certain words are more closely connected to the others and about the relationship between these words in a sentence. Okay, and they know, they have in mind that words are grouped together to create larger units that is called constituents. Okay, and words are grouped in a hierarchical manner that is called hierarchical structure. We are going to demonstrate this in the next slide. So how is constituency represented? Syntax have different methods in describing or in representing this phenomenon of constituency. That is by stating the rules, how words are grouped into larger units, and these larger units combine into even larger units, and so on, up to the sentence as the largest unit of analysis in syntax. There are basically three ways. The first one is called rewrite rules, and the second method is called bracketing, and the third is tree diagram. Let's discuss about the first method, rewrite rules. Rewrite rules is the method in which mathematical rules are used to describe the constituency or to represent the constituency. For example, we return to this sentence, the student loves his syntax assignment. If we label each of the words here, so we come up with the is a determiner, student is an N noun, love is a verb, his is another determiner, and then syntax is adjective, and then assignment is a noun. And then we can represent this into several rules. Number one, from the top, we see that A sentence consists of noun phrase plus verb phrase plus noun phrase. You see that I use index 1 and 2 to determine to show that these two noun phrases are two different noun phrase. Okay, and then noun phrase 1 consists of determiner the and students d plus n. Even though later I'm not going to use this plus sign because it is against the rule that words or sentences are not sequential. Okay, so I only use this to demonstrate the concept that noun phrase is a combination of a determinant and a noun, right? And then the second is VP. So we have a verb plus noun phrase. Okay, and this noun phrase in turns consists of a determiner, and then we have another part which is adjective phrase syntax. You may kind of puzzle why I say that syntax is adjective phrase. Why not a noun, for example, as we believe that syntax is a kind of study, it must be a noun. But in this for this presentation, I'm going to state temporarily that syntax should be considered as adjective. Okay, I'm going to talk about it later. And then we have adjective phrase, which consists of one adjective syntax. Okay, and please take notes that this is just an approximation, that the real rules are far more complex than this. Okay, and we see that some mathematical symbols are used to indicate the relationship between words as well as the hierarchy. So we see, for example, we have arrow. The arrow here should be read as consists of. So when we say S, arrow, NP, VP, NP, means that sentence should be should consist of noun phrase, verb phrase, and noun phrase. Okay, now let's move on to the second method, which is bracketing. Bracketing is a technique or method in which we use brackets to represent the relationship between constituents. So if you see in the same example, the student loves his syntax assignment, we see some brackets, and I make an even bigger brackets outside, because it means that the bigger brackets will enclose smaller brackets. Yeah, okay, so it's like stacking. This is quite complicated if you don't know the principle, but it's actually the similar thing that we have seen in the previous method. Okay, but now I would like you to concentrate on this third method, which is tree diagramming. Using tree diagram, we can represent the constituency. So if you see here, the tree diagram usually start from the largest unit on the top to the smallest unit. So it is similar reading from the first and the second method. If we can read this, we can read this such something like a sentence consists of noun phrase and verb phrase. The first noun phrase in turn is combination of determiner plus noun. And then the VP consists of verb plus NP, and the second NP consists of determiner, adjective phrase, and noun. And the adjective phrase consists of one adjective only, which is syntax, right? Okay, now if you see the comparison, the tree diagram on the left is also is similar to the representation of the mathematics in the right side. Okay. Now let's move on to the next thing, which is phrase structure rules. So what is phrase structure rules? Phrase structure rules are the rules that generate the phrase structure tree of a sentence, which is called a phrase structure rule or PSR. In generative grammar, generalizations about structure are represented by PSR. So in a way, it's the grammar or the rules. Okay, so in order to be able to combine the words into sentences grammatically, native speakers of English have a notion, the mental grammar, that is represented by the syntactician by a set of rules that is called PSR. This rule, okay, so this is a kind of introduction. We are going to go deeper into this in our next video. So the rule that we are talking about here must minimally generate a certain phrase that we call XP, that contains X as the head. So I use X here as a variable that you can change into whatever category that you want. For example, We can change at x into n, so you create np that contains a head n, and then vp verb phrase which consists of the head v. So this concept is called headedness or endocentricity in grammar or in syntax. There is a notion that a certain phrase should consist of minimally the head of its own category. Okay, so in order to understand the PSR, you need to know first part of speech or syntactic categories. So we have discussed this in our previous video when we are talking about part of speech, and we will use a part of speech here to be labels. And then, so in this discussion, we are going to combine our notion about labels, about the word category or syntactic categories, and the rules. Okay, and this will comprise the knowledge of syntax. Now, let's move on a little bit into what is a phrase. My first approximation of phrase is a group of words centered around one word of a certain syntactic category serving as a head. So there are two characteristics of a phrase. Number one, it should be centered around one word, okay, which is called head. Yeah, so for example, verb phrase should be headed by verb, noun phrase should be headed by noun, and so on and so forth. And then the second, it can consist of only one word. Okay, so for example, the word books in my notes below, the word like books is already considered to be a phrase. It is a noun phrase because it consists of minimally one word, which is a noun. Okay, and then a certain phrase only requires one word having the same category of the phrase. Okay, and this notion is called endocentricity or headedness. And other elements that modify the head is always in form of phrases and either optional or required depending on the head features. In our previous video, we have talked about features. So let's take an example, a verb. Okay, a transitive verb has a feature that needs a noun. So we will say that a VP in which the verb is a transitive will require a noun phrase following the head. Okay, and then this is our way of categorize or of symbolizing this phrase. We use P. So for example, NP, VP, adjective phrase, adjective, ADJP, and so on. Okay, and let's see how this construction are represented or symbolized in rules. For example, NP consists of N, books, okay, or even larger, a boy, which consists of determiner, noun, and determiner and noun, and a handsome boy, which is even larger, consisting of determiner, adjective phrase, and N. Okay. So this is the phrase. Now let's take a look at example of one kind of phrase, which is quite popular, noun phrase. Okay, so noun phrase can consist of a single noun, books for example, or it can take the determiner as a modifier, or adjective phrase like in interesting books. So adjective phrase is the modifier of noun, books, and then we have an even larger construction, the interesting books, and then we can noun can also take a PP, prepositional phrase, as its modifier. So like for example, in phrase books of syntax, and then we have an even larger construction, the books on syntax, okay, and even larger ones, the interests on syntax. Please take a note that brackets here denotes optional elements, as we discussed before that a phrase only require a head of its category. So it noun phrase only need N, the others are optional. Okay? And the arrangement here occurs in sequence. So for example, we have the books D and N. We cannot rearrange this into books the, because it will create a crash, or it will create ungrammaticality in the sentence, in the construction. Okay, So we don't use the plus symbol here. So we delete it because we don't want to create an impression that you can rearrange it whatever you want. So it should be considered to be following a certain sequence. Okay. Now let's take another example. For example, verb phrase. Verb phrase is relatively more difficult to discuss because verbs can be subcategorized into based on its transitivity. So, for example, Andy left, in which left is an intransitive verb and it does not require any noun phrase as the complement or as the object whatsoever. Okay, but Matt, for example, in John met Lucy, Matt is transitive and it requires a noun phrase following the verb, right? And we have an even more complex situation of ditransitive, in which the verb like put require two instead of one element of noun phrase or element of object. Okay, so we need the books and on the table as two objects, right? That is called in grammar direct and indirect object. And then we can even combine verb with adverbial phrase. For example, in the sentence she dances beautifully, in which beautifully is an adverbial phrase that modify the verb. Okay, we have an even more complex example here. They always study math diligently at home, in which the verb component is modified by various elements. So we have adverbial phrase in the beginning, adverbial phrase at the end, and then we have noun phrase, and then we have PP or professional phrase at home. So that's how we represent these rules into rewrite rules. Okay, now let me make it short by making a tentative summary. So these rules can be found in your textbook. So these are some rules that we have already known about of phrase, right? With even with extension to lexical, the so-called lexical categories. I'm going to talk about this later when we are talking about X-bar theory. So one short question: how do we know that constituent is really constituent? I'm not going to go deep into this, but there are the so-called constituency tests that you can learn from your textbook to determine whether a certain component is a constituent of a larger larger group or not. We have several known tests, which is called substitution test, movement test, and coordination test. And hopefully you can learn about this in deep at home. And then you see that we discuss about tree diagramming as one method in representing the constituency in of a grammar. So how do we do that? There are basically two ways. The first one is called bottom up. Bottom up means you draw the tree diagram from the bottom, from the words into the larger unit, into the sentence. And top down is the reverse process, in which you start from the largest unit into the smallest unit. So you draw the tree diagrams from top, bottom, top down, or bottom up. Which one is easier? Some people say that bottom up tree diagramming technique is easier. So that's what I'm going to do in the next slide. But actually, both are okay. You can try to learn both. And if you, as soon as you understand the configuration, it will be even easier and even faster to do the top down tree diagramming. Okay, so I'm going to talk about this later in the next video. So what is the basic procedures for bottom up drawing? The first one, we have to label the words correctly by using the part of speech that we have already discussed. And then we draw the trees to group words belonging to the same group, which is called phrase, from the bottom to the top, and we proceed to the larger units. And as sentence is the largest unit of syntax analysis, so we will stop in sentence level. Okay, now let's do some demonstration. I'm going to use the same. So here's syntax assignment. Pay attention to syntax, because I'm trying to simplify here, but it should be even more complex than this. But this is only approximation. So we come up with the second noun phrase. Okay, and then this noun phrase is the required modifier of the verb love. So we create an even larger construction called VP, which consists of one verb plus one NP as the modifier. Okay, and then finally we combine NP and VP into the largest unit, which is called sentence. Or another term for this, which is more accurate, is called TP, which is tense phrase that we are going to use as the category in the next video. Okay, so I think that's all my presentation. Before I end this, I would like to do some exercise. So I would like you to draw a tree diagram based on these three phrases. Some clever kids, very happy, and clean the floor. Okay, so I'm going to give you about 2 minutes to think about this. Insufficient concept in this. So an even better solution is something like this. Okay, so why? What is the difference? The difference is adjective here should be considered as adjective phrase, because I told you before that every modifier of a phrase should be a phrase. So instead of using a word, adjective, we have to consider it as a phrase that will later be extended into adjective. Okay, still there is something wrong with the D here, because the D is not a phrase. Okay, but we will discuss about that a little bit later. Okay, because it's a more complex idea. Even if we see later, this is an even better solution. We are using the theory called X-bar theory that I'm going to discuss in the next video. Okay, so this is an even better solution. Okay, but if you come up with the second diagram like this one, it's okay. It's not really that incorrect. Okay, now what about the second? Very happy. How do you draw the diagram? Okay, this is the diagram that you may come up. If you did this, then you did it successfully. Okay, so we have adjective happy as the head, and adverbial phrase very as the modifier of the head, right? Okay, and this is an even more complex X-bar theory diagram that we are going to talk later. And then what about the third one, clean the floor? Okay, did you come up with this? Okay, so verb, then we have NP, the complement, and then the NP consists of two words, the and floor. Okay, and this is an X-bar version of the diagram. Yeah, but you see, this may look complicated because you will see that there is an empty place that I left there, and I did that intentionally. There is a reason why we put a blank there that I'm going to discuss in X-bar theory. Okay, so I think that's my presentation. Hopefully you learned something from this, and I'm going to draw some summaries here. Number one, native speakers of a language has intuition of the relationship between words in a sentence and how words are grouped into larger unit. And this phenomenon is called constituency. And then words are grouped hierarchically. This is called hierarchical structure. So that's why we see that the tree diagrams is used to show or to represent this hierarchy, that one unit can be combined into a larger unit, a larger unit can be combined into an even larger unit. And we know that syntax discuss from the level of words to phrase to clause to sentences, right? And then syntax aims at formulating rules that can capture the phenomenon of constituency. These rules you have already known is called phrase structure rules. And then the rules discussed in this presentation is tentative. So once again, tentative, because we are going to modify is this again and again until we come up with an even more accurate or more accurate way of representing the grammar or the syntax of a sentence. And then as we proceed through the lesson, we will reformulate the rules. Okay, however, in the time being, I think this rule is relatively okay. You can hold that for now, and later we are going to do some reformulation. Okay, and here are the words of the day that you can learn. Hopefully you can learn further by reading your books and then try to find out a formal definition of this concept, constituency, constituent, and so on and so on. Okay, and this is my bibliography. And I think that's all my presentation. Thank you very much for joining me in this session of video. And in the next video, we are going to talk about an even more accurate, even more complex theory called X-bar theory, where I'm going to talk about how the current trend of syntax deal with sentence construction. Okay, hopefully you learned something, and I really encourage you to learn beforehand. So don't wait until the next video is coming. You can start reading from now. I think that's all from